Hello everyone, I'm Priyanka. I will be speaking to you about staging of cervical cancer in this talk. This is the last lecture of my series of talks on pelvic MRI imaging. So this is going to be the flow of the talk. We'll touch briefly on the epidemiology, the role of MRI, staging using MRI, talk about recurrence and fertility sparing surgery. Cervical cancer is the fourth most common cancer in women worldwide, and it is the second most common cancer in women in India. It accounts for about a quarter of all cases worldwide. There is a steady decline in cases in the developed countries due to screening, whereas in India, the five-year survival rate is still quite poor at almost 50%. Risk factors include HPV, which is the main one, smoking, contraceptive use, multiparity, multiple sex partners, and sex at young age. It tends to happen in women between 35 to 60 years of age. Because of association of risk with HPV, prevention is possible using HPV vaccines and HPV DNA-based screening. In developed countries, this used to be done with pap smears, which has now been replaced with cervical screening test. WHO has classified cervical tumors into three separate epithelial tumor subtypes. The most common one is squamous cell carcinoma, which accounts for about 80% of the cases. The remaining are adenocarcinomas with other rare varieties reported. For some reason, squamous cell carcinoma has better prognosis than adenocarcinoma. Now, the squamous cell carcinoma tends to arise in the squamocolumnar junction, while the adenocarcinoma arises in the ectocervix. The squamocolumnar junction is in the ectocervix in younger patients, which regresses to the endocervical canal with age. Therefore, we tend to see that younger women have an exophytic mass, whereas the older women will have an endophytic lesion. Clinically, most of these women are asymptomatic, or they might present with intermenstrual bleeding or postmenopausal bleeding and other non-specific symptoms. Initial investigation is done using ultrasound, and staging is done with MRI and PET-CT scan. Staging is done using the FIGO method. Similar to endometrial cancers, FIGO and event division for cervical cancers as well, such that stage 1B now has three separate subgroups, and lymph nodes have been incorporated into the current FIGO staging in stage 3. Also similar to endometrial cancer, previously radiology was not part of FIGO staging. So MRI is the method of choice for local regional extent. Now, unlike endometrial cancers, dynamic contrast enhanced sequence is still a research tool. It can demonstrate invasion into the adjacent tissues better, but is not recommended for staging of cervical cancer. So you can perform MRI without administering contrast. It can also help identify tiny tumors in women who are considering fertility sparing surgery. Diffusion, on the other hand, is helpful, and together with T2 varied images helps to delineate the tumor better. So this image just shows how to protocol your scans. So the blue part is tumor in the cervix. Your axials should be oriented perpendicular to the endocervical canal, and your true coronals are going to be perpendicular to these. On MR, the tumor is going to be isointense to cervical stroma on T1 sequence, and it's going to be hyperintense compared to the cervical stroma on T2 sequences. If we do give contrast, the tumor is going to be more enhancing than the adjacent cervical stroma, and we tend to have restricted diffusion. Here is an example. We have a normal cervix, an MRI of a normal patient. You see the endocervical lining, and this is the cervical stroma. In between, we see the junctional zone as a low T2 signal, and then the outer cervical stromal ring of low T2 signal. On axial, we see a low T2 signal rim, then the cervical stroma, then the junctional zone, and the hyperintense component in the center is the endometrial lining. Then the adjacent parametrial fat. Please note that we do have some vessels in the parametrium. So when we do discuss tumor, don't tend to call these as tumor extension to the parametrium, because the parametrial fat is vascular and therefore does have some internal striations. This is just to show a tumor into the cervix, which is on T2 is heterogeneously slightly hyperintense and demonstrates restricted diffusion. Now moving on to staging. Stage 1, cancer is strictly confined to the cervix. 1A is microscopic, and therefore we're not going to see an MRI. Stage 1b, tumor is still confined to the uterine cervix and has three separate subtypes. Stage 1b1, 1b2, and 1b3. These sizes are going to be, 1b1 is between 5 millimeters to 2 centimeters. 1b2 is between 2 to 4, and 1b3 is more than 4 centimeters. And the size is the maximum dimension in any plane. This allows for risk stratification and identify patients who are candidates for fertility sparing surgery. With stage 1B, 1 and 2, there's a significantly increased risk of death, which is almost double in stage 1B, 2. Therefore, they are recommended to undergo pelvic lymphadenectomy and radiotherapy, whereas 1B, 1 can benefit from limited surgery. Here we've got an example. There's a tiny T2 hyperintense lesion in the ectocervix. If we measure, it's going to be small. I know part of the remaining structure is also hyperintense. But this was the tumor, and this is going to be a stage 1B1 disease. Another case, we see a tumor which is to the left of the midline. It does involve the endocervix here. We have lost the internal inner rim of junctional zone, and then it's involving the cervical stroma. But the outer rim is still intact. So this is stage 1B2 tumor. And on this one, we say the tumor is right. It's causing expansion of the posterior cervical wall, and it's going to be more than 4 centimeters in length if we measure here. This is stage 1B3. So there is not much to add for me here. It's just that you have to identify the tumor, which is going to be T2 hyperintense, and it's going to have restricted diffusion, and measure to decide whether it's which stage of 1B it is. Moving on to stage 2 cancers, these extend beyond the uterus but not to the lower third of vagina or the pelvic side wall. Now 2A is going to involve the upper two thirds of vagina, and again we've got subtypes, subgroups in it based on size. Stage 2B will extend into the parametrium, in which you are going to lose the low signal rim of the cervical stroma. And it's going to cause speculated and nodular outline of the tumor and parametrium interface. It might encase the parametrial vessels. Here we've got a tumor in the cervix. There's going to be no difficulty in identifying this. And then we can see this is the posterior vaginal fornix and anterior vaginal fornix. And that is tumor extending into the upper vagina. So this is stage 2A. How do you decide whether tumor is in the upper vagina or lower vagina? You can draw a line through the base of bladder, through the neck of the bladder, and see where it intersects the vagina. Whatever you have above it, which is here, that's going to be the upper vagina, and whatever you have below is going to be the lower vagina. In this case, this is an axial small field of view, true axial through the cervix. We see the tumor involving most of the cervix. And then we see these additional striations into the parametrium and then nodular outline. Also, we cannot appreciate the low signal rim of the cervical stroma. So this is extension into the parametrium, and this is stage 2B disease. Stage 3, tumor is going to extend into the lower third of vagina. Appearances are going to be similar to what I showed for stage 2A, just that it is going to go below the line through the bladder base. It can extend to the pelvic side wall, and the definition of pelvic side wall is similar to endometrial cancer, which is going to be less than 3 millimeters distance between tumor and the true pelvic pole. Please don't overcall based on peritumoral enhancement or fat stranding. So it has to be distance between the actual tumor and this pelvic side wall. Stage 3C is going to be pelvic lymph node involvement or para-aortic lymph node involvement. And these, again, are similar to what we have already discussed in endometrial CA staging. Stage 4, again, is identical to CA endometrium. Tumor extends beyond the true pelvis and involves the mucosa of bladder and rectum. So tumor touching the bladder wall is not stage 4. It has to involve the mucosa for either the bladder or the rectum. Stage 4B is distant metastasis. Here we've got a case of cervical tumor. This is an image I've taken off the internet. It is extending into the bladder wall very clearly. And the coronal views, again, we can see there is tumor seen within the urinary bladder. So this is the tumor. In some cases, as I said, we may see tumor touching the serosal margin. That may not be tumor stage 4A. In those cases, we can look at contrast-enhanced sequences if there is any enhancing tumor seen within the bladder, or sometimes a fused image of the two various sequence and diffusion imaging might help. And if you do not see any activity or any restricted diffusion within the bladder wall, then it might not be bladder wall invasion. Lymph nodes, there is not much which is different in lymph node staging of cervical cancer from endometrial cancer. The size you can take as 1 cm or 0.8 and 1 cm as discussed previously. Now, MRI has limited sensitivity in detecting metastatic disease in normal size lymph nodes, but this can be resolved with PET CT scan, and this is recommended for most patients who have higher grade of cervical tumor. So what you do not see on MRI should be picked up on PET CT scan. Therefore, PET CT is recommended for anyone who has stage 1B, 2 or above disease. So this is going to be how we plan treatment. We perform an MRI if patient has a low-grade disease and is not a candidate for fertility sparing, then patient undergoes surgery and that's curative. For patients who have higher stage disease, they need to undergo PET CT scan. If there is pelvic lymph node involvement, these patients have to go for pelvic radiation and chemotherapy. If there is distant metastasis, they go for chemotherapy and radiation. And in periotic lymph node involvement, they have to undergo pelvic and periotic radiation and chemotherapy. So recurrence is going to have similar appearance as primary cancer. MRI is the modality of choice. Unlike MRI that we perform for staging primary cancer, contrast enhanced sequences do have a role here. And this is to differentiate inflammatory tissue and fibrosis from tumor recurrence. So recurrence is going to enhance in early and late phase of the scan, whereas fibrosis will poorly enhance and inflammation might enhance to some degree. And they both can have restricted diffusion, so that does not have much of a role in recurrence. On PET CT scan, there's a possibility that there'll be some metabolic activity that you see for up to 3 to 6 months post-treatment, and that's probably related to inflammation. So please do not overcall that. And for doubtful cases, maybe review together with the clinical presentation and MRI and PET CT scan findings. If patient underwent radiotherapy for management of primary cancer, then they have to undergo radical surgery now for recurrence. Whereas if they did not have radiotherapy for primary cancer management, they can now undergo chemoradiotherapy for management of recurrence. Briefly touching upon fertility sparing surgery. So the eligibility criteria for that is any histological subtype, tumor stage 1B, 1 or less. Tumor is at least 1 cm away from the internal nose. There is less than 50% involvement of the cervical stroma and there is no nodal disease. If the patient does decide to go for this surgery, then MRI is recommended for these patients to be done first to be done at 6 months and then to be done annually. Now, sometimes we see tumors from endometrium extending down to the cervix and there can be a bulky cervical mass. And it's important to distinguish whether it's a primarily an endometrial cancer or primarily a cervical cancer because the management is very different. So there are findings which can help. If we see bulk of tumor to be centered in cervix, then it is going to be a cervical cancer. Whereas if bulk of tumor is in the endometrium, then it is going to be endometrial cancer. Also, endometrial cancers tend to distend the endometrial cavity, whereas cervical cancers might just extend upwards but not distend. I'm sorry for this image. Don't get confused because this is just to show that the two can look similar. But if we pay attention to the features that I've just described, we will be able to differentiate the two. Worst case scenario, biopsy will be helpful to decide which one it is. So in summary, cervical cancer MRI is the standard of care for staging and you do not necessarily need to give contrast for primary staging MRI. PET CT scan is indicated for patients who've got higher grade or stage disease. Assess the patient for possibility of fertility sparing surgery. And also assess if the patient is a surgical candidate for management. That will be all. Thank you so much for listening. I hope you enjoyed the talk.